like you hate it now, but wait till you drive it.
The Kibbe and Friends Show.
What it is, bro?
Presented by Holly Performance, makers of the world's best air and fuel delivery systems. Featuring Rob Kibbe.
I don't know how to put this, but kind of a big deal.
Justin Corndog Cornette.
New guy's in the corner puking his guts out.
And show producer Bernie McPartland.
This is the DJ 3000, and it has three distinct varieties of inane chatter.
We're talking cars.
Do you feel this vehicle is safe for highway travel?
Yes, I do.
Diving deep on the topics that matter most.
Just when I think you couldn't possibly be any dumber, you go and do something like this.
And totally redeem yourself!
And the Dukes of Hazzard. Available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and wherever you get your content.
Turn up the volume.
This is the Kibbe and Friend Show.
Kibbe and Friend Show, episode number 191. Available in Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Play, iHeartRadio, Instagram, YouTube back in the day, and Patreon back in today. Well, technically today. I am your host, Rob Kibbe, period. With me, as always, is no one. That's right. You heard me. We are not here. So here's the scoop. Bernie's not here. Corndog's not here. Well, I'll tell you everything. My dad turns 80 tomorrow. We're going to Kansas City to catch a Royals baseball game. And Bernie's not in town right now because he went to Houston to, you know what? I don't even know what he's doing in Houston. I doubt he's going to a baseball game. Probably going to NASA to do radios or something. Corndog technically could do the show this week, but isn't he clever? He has a few line items in his contract, one of which says he does not have to do the show by himself. I did not know that until we were preparing for this week's show. And it's kind of good for me that it's there, because if he does the show by himself, what does he need us for? And that's what Finnegan found out the hard way. So, nonetheless, you got no new show for us this week. So we're going to do something. This is an automotive and pop culture show. We're going to do a replay. A rerun, you might say.
Yeah, well, I saw it on a rerun.
It's a rerun.
This is a rebroadcast of our very first movie review as a new crew in 2019. So if you are new to the show, and like way new, this show started out with me and Mike Finnegan, and it was called The Kibbe and Finnegan Show. And we started reviewing The Dukes of Hazzard, starting with season one, episode one. And then we started inserting other pop culture movies, car movies, things that we liked. In January of 2019, Finnegan was gone, Corndog was in, and we added in Bernie as our producer, and he was only supposed to speak just a little bit, and then, wouldn't you know it, nature took its course. So, you now have this intrepid trio, but our first few shows were, as you might guess, we figured things out. As whoever left us that iTunes review once said, I don't think that we didn't sound like friends. We're certainly getting to know how to do this. So, this is Back to the Future, which I think we did either in March or April of 2019. This is when we are finally starting to click. So I think it's kind of an interesting one to do. And is there any better way to justify a rerun than by replaying a review of a review that you already did about a time travel movie? Kind of makes sense if you think about it. Now, I know what you're saying. Isn't this mailing it in a little bit? Doing it kind of half-ass? Well, technically, yes. But as a great man once said,
if you don't like your job, you don't strike. You just go in every day and do it really half-assed. That's the American way.
So with that, let's get to it. Therefore, the Back to the Future review is presented by the great people at Holly Performance. Now, Lord knows, those DeLoreans sucked in the speed department. But if Holly had got a hold of them, they'd have been as fast as they sounded. They sounded fast because sound effects from a Porsche 928 were dubbed in and replaced that pukey DeLorean PRV motor. I've seen several motor swaps in a DeLorean. Sure, you have two. The ones that kind of stick out in my mind are Cadillac Northstars, which makes sense because that would be a V8 with a transaxle, and obviously a lot of LS motors. So if a DeLorean has an LS motor, would it qualify to go to Holly's LS fast? Here comes the plug. Yes, it would. It absolutely would. And this year's Holly LS Fest in Bowling Green is September 10th through 12th and is a celebration of everything and anything powered by the incredible GM LS engine and LT engine. Do they call it LS and LST Fest? No, it's called LS Fest because that still works, but if you got an LT, you can come. Drag race, autocross, drift challenge, road course, 3S challenges are like the speed step. There's a dyno challenge. There's a burnout competition. There's a bolt on power challenge, which I'm actually not even sure what that one is. It's all available at lsfest.com. But what I want you to do is click the link to go to that website in the show notes below. That'll take you right to the page that you need to go. Actually, it'll allow you to sign up for any of their upcoming events this September and October, which is Holly's LS Fest, Mo Party, and the Ford Festival. All good things. Make sure that you go check us out. Go to one of those events. You're missing out if you've never gone to one of those. They're all at the exact same place. Honestly, if you go to one, you'll probably get addicted enough to go to another one. But if you got a Chevy, then you need a Mopar and a Ford. So there are worse things to spend your money on. Okay, that's coming up below. Thank you, by the way. Holly re-upped for the next quarter for us as title sponsor of this show. Don't stop clicking those links, though, in our show notes or we're in trouble. But I just want to thank you because I owe you one. Patreon. I'm just going to tell you what the Patreon deserving listener donation is going to be. I already put it out on Instagram. It's a custom piece of art, actually, but it's a cut and painted wood piece, and I'm not describing that nearly well enough. It's actually a boss hog holding a cigar, wearing his white hat, and then under the bottom of it, it says, "Like a Boss." It was produced by Steve and Gail Boyce at Dirt Road Endeavors. If you're on Patreon, as soon as you see me put out our request for your questions for this month's Patreon Q&A show, put in there why you deserve to win this thing. Remember, if you're at the $5 level, you're eligible within 6 months of being at the $5 level. If you're at the $10 level or higher, you're eligible immediately. I don't know what this thing would cost. I offered to buy it. Steve refused. He just wanted to support the show in that way. It's a really, really, really awesome prize. Make sure that you visit Dirt Road Endeavors to check out everything else that is they make. Our show plaque that's behind me on the wall. I have several nice items here that they have made. But this is a big deal. You're going to want to win this. Out of all the people who put in why you should win it, remember, funny rises to the top. Funny and dumb really rises to the top for me. I'm going to choose a few top contenders. And our guest host, our quad host, Dan Atkinson, will pick the winner. Dan, it cannot be you. And it cannot be your wife. If you want to scam the system beyond that, that's actually fair play, but don't do it right in front of us. So patreon.com/KF show is where you need to go. Okay. I think that's it. This is the world. Wait a minute. Okay. Back to the future. I promise. I am a fan of Seth MacFarlane. You know, I'm for Family Guy, and yeah, Family Guy is what it is. There's a lot of raunchy humor, but sometimes it's so on point, it makes you cry. This is a little clip from his 2015 movie called A Million Ways to Die in the West. It's set in the Old West in the 1800s in California. If you've seen Back to the Future 3, this is going to make perfect sense.
Hello? What's that?
Nothing. It's a weather experiment.
Oh.
Great Scott!
That's as awesome as it sounds. I don't remember if we talked about that in the original review, but that's this cameo of Seth MacFarlane he's riding his horse, and he sees this barn, and there's all sorts of like blue light coming out of it, and he opens the door, and it's Doc Brown. It's pretty awesome. Okay, if you're on Patreon, we'll talk to you next week. If not, you should join for sure. This show will be back. No, it won't be back the last week of June. This is a 5-week month. I don't think we're actually on schedule to come back till after the 4th of July. Holy crap, that may change, but technically we won't be back until after the 4th of July. So if I don't talk to you till then, come out to the Good Guy Show in Des Moines if you're so able, July 2 through 4. I'll have Kibby Lee there at least one day, loaded with stickers to give away. That's neither here nor there. So hope to see you on Patreon. Here is the rebroadcast of Back to the Future from episode 107. Enjoy.
Just a good old boy, never meaning no harm.
Well, let's go ahead and get to our Back to the Future review. And you know what? I think all you need to do is just hear a few things, and you, if you hear this song, tell me immediately what you think of. Right?
Oh, yeah. Right.
It just switch on. It's perfect, and it's still an awesome song. But whenever I hear Huey Lewis in the News, any other song, I always think of Back to the Future, and specifically Power of Love. I saw this movie in the theater, and I remember seeing it in the theater. Bernie, is this one that you saw in person?
Absolutely. I remember it. I've seen them all in the theater.
I did, too. Little side note. In 10th grade, in the marching band, we did a Hollywood theme, and the Back to the Future soundtrack was one of our songs. I still know the tenor drum part.
Tenor drums?
Yeah. So I played bass drum, tenor drums, and then a couple years on snare drum in high school. Tenor drums look like a bunch of bongos.
Oh,
little
okay.
Bongos to all big right. Bongos, and they sit out in front of you. But
they're not the quads, are they?
Yeah, you can call them quads, four? Quints. I think they're used as sixes now. Did you see this one in the theater? You might be too young.
Yeah, I was too young, but we did rent it from the local video store whenever it came out. Maybe the statute of limitations has expired, but we copied it over from one VCR to the other. And so we had our own copy. We watched that video over and over and over. We watched it probably at least two or three times a week. I don't know why, but we just love that movie.
My parents, this was absolutely their time period. They were teenagers in the 50s. They loved this movie. And it's hard for me to get the context, but in 1980, that's only 30 years after high school. I am now of the age where 30 years ago I was almost in high school. So it starts to line up with that time jump. But they freaking loved this movie. Every inside joke, all the Johnny B. Good references. I remember my mom laughing out loud when Marty McFly was doing the duck walk, like doing Johnny B. Good, like she just thought that was the best thing. And it's a timeless movie.
Yeah.
And it's timeless because it's a time travel movie. That's the freaking wonderful beauty genius of it. And what I was hoping to do here was just go through a number of facts, and I pulled some clips, and this is an impossible movie to pull clips for because the whole movie is one big clip. Yeah. There's so many quotable things in here. There's so many great lines. There's so many inside baseball references that we've probably all learned over the years. Where I would like to start here is with Christopher Lloyd. Now, Christopher Lloyd was in the TV show Taxi, I believe, and I don't know his career prior to Back to the Future super well. But I do know that the biggest thing he had done prior to that was as a Klingon in Star Trek III. I have prepared this clip for you.
My lord, the ship appears to be deserted.
How can that be? They're hiding.
See? Yes, sounds sir. Like Doc Brown, doesn't
it? But the bridge seems to be run by computer. It is the only thing speaking.
Speaking? Let me hear.
9, 8,
check this out.
7, 6.
You know what just happened there?
Something blew up.
Doc Brown got outsmarted by Captain Kirk. Captain Kirk tricked all the Klingons onto the Enterprise, except that guy, except Doc Brown, and then he blew up the Enterprise, killed all those Klingons. Anyway, what's that? Michael J. Fox, of course, was on the TV show, which I don't know if you watch this in reruns, but this was the Family Ties song, and what everybody listening probably now knows but was a mind blower to me was that Michael J. Fox was the original candidate to play Marty McFly, but he was not the first actor to do it.
That's right.
Yes. Bernie, do you know the story?
Wasn't it Jason Bateman? He was the first one?
Well, there are several that did it, but Eric Stoltz was the guy that filmed almost the entire movie.
They said it was like 5 weeks worth of filming. He just wasn't fit for the part. And then so they had to go back and reshoot everything, 5 weeks worth.
Yeah. I do know there were several. I knew Jason was one, and I knew that because I saw like everyone in the world, saw the YouTube clip, but I didn't know how many and what order they were in. That was never really clear.
I didn't realize he was one. I think Charlie Sheen was actually one in there. John Cusack was one.
I think the Gilmore Girls were in line for that.
Yeah, Gilmore Girls were possibly in there.
Yeah.
I did have an interesting part about Michael J. Fox. He was actually on, when they wrote it, they actually kind of wrote it with Michael J. Fox in mind, but he was filming Teen Wolf, the movie. So they presented it to him, but he was actually in the middle of filming. I had a contract with Family Ties, and so that was going to kind of keep him out of it. And then after they filmed with the first guy, Eric, they made the call and said, this isn't going to work. And then they ended up reworking a deal with whoever had the contract with Family Ties. And they said, as long as it doesn't interrupt his filming with Family Ties. And so he would film all day long with Family Ties, leave there, and then go straight to Back to the Future and film till like 4 o'clock in the morning.
I think it's a pretty famous run where they had a Ford LTD wagon with a mattress in the back.
Yeah.
And they would pick him up from Family Ties and he would sleep in it on the way over there. And then they'd let him shoot all night and then they'd take him home and he'd sleep for like 3 hours and somebody would wake him up and take him to Family Ties. And somehow he did this. That's the most amazing thing about it, is that this huge empire for us, for Michael J. Fox, was probably like 5 weeks.
Yeah.
That's about it. another interesting thing. So in high school, we toured Universal Studios. I remember like the Florida one, and they had some replica stuff there. So many people have gotten the Universal Studios backlot, the small town, confused with the Warner Brothers small town. They look similar, but they're not the same thing.
Right.
The Back to the Future town, Hill Valley, I think is also the same town from Animal House, like the final scene of Animal House. I'm pretty sure it's on the Universal backlot.
I'd have to look at that and see.
Like the street where the DeLorean goes down to catch the light pole by the clock tower to go back to the future. At the very, I believe that's the same street that the Deathmobile from Animal House is driving down. I think that's all the same stuff. Some interesting things that have been kind of revealed out over the years. And Bob Gale and Bob Zemeckis are the two people known with this. Bob Gale's a co-writer. Bob Zemeckis, director and co-writer. The original time machine was going to be a refrigerator.
Yeah.
Which later got worked into a different Steven Spielberg production as not as a time machine. It was in the latest Indiana Jones movie, where that's how Indiana Jones escaped a nuclear blast, was by getting in a refrigerator, because old school refrigerators, I think, were lead lined. That's where the lead lined.
Okay.
Protection from that. The idea to put it in a car came up just for logistics. And the reason they chose the DeLorean was because John DeLorean, the man, was on trial and it was all over the news. And as they looked at the car, it was silver and it kind of looked like a spaceship. Then something interesting happened. I'm going to see if I can pull the clip here.
I already know the clip. I already got it.
I'll bet it's the same one as you. Product placement clip. Let's see.
We're locked into the DeLorean. That's what we want to do. We had the product placement people at Universal. They're always trying to promote deals, right?
Right, right.
And so one day, the guy that they'd hired to actually do the product placement deals, he comes into my office. He says, Bob, we can get the production $75,000. $75,000 on this deal I'm about to lay out for you. I say, okay, Richard, what's the deal? He says, change the DeLorean to a Mustang. I look at him. I said, Doc Brown doesn't drive Mustang.
Right, right.
That was it.
Wow. That was $75,000 out the window.
Worth it.
Yeah. Well, that's
from Jay Leno's garage. Is that the one you had pulled too?
No, I was thinking of the clip in the movies. I figured if you're going to build a time machine, why not do it with some style?
Yeah.
I read that they wanted it to be something that kind of, like you said, kind of looked futuristic and, mm-hmm. and all that kind of stuff. They wanted it to look, just had the cool factor, but they also wanted the overall, not just the DeLorean, but the time machine. They wanted it to look like something that was kind of cobbled together in a garage.
Yeah.
That's kind of how they come up with the whole look of it.
I'm going to play for you a clip of the DeLorean. The first sight and sound you get of DeLorean are coming out of a trailer.
Yeah.
I'll play this, but everybody, you don't even need to see it to know what it is. A DeLorean has a PRV engine. This is what a DeLorean's real engine sounds like. Prepare to be disappointed. I can't take it.
You sure that's not your Karmagia?
That sound like my Karmagia. That's a DeLorean with the cat removed, so that's actually a better sounding version of it. What they use in the movie, what everywhere I've ever read, is said it's a Porsche 928, which is a V8 engine. Here's another little clip of it. Actually, the clip we were talking about before, when it's going back to the future. It's just a great sounding engine. I mean, it sounds throaty. It sounds mean. Mm-hmm. It sounds fast. And the way that I have read this and watched different documentaries is that a few different people helped design this car. The same person that did the design for this car, like the artistic design, was also one of the guys who I think designed the entire dash of KITT from Knight Rider. I don't have his name handy, but...
There was a guy named Kevin Pike. He did special effects. And he was really kind of over the buildup of the cars.
He did electronics
and stuff, but he may not be the same guy.
This was the guy who went, who did the artistic rendering and then built it, I believe. A real visionary kind of person, but the DeLorean's kind of a hatchback. The car itself has a weenie engine, but it's really based on, I think, a Lotus Esprit type suspension and chassis setup. So it could be capable. No power steering. It's kind of a clunker, like Jay Leno in his little clip that he was doing with what we pull there. It's like you always see DeLoreans going down the road, and they're always sniffing the white line. You know, that was the whole John DeLorean reference because, A, the cars drove like crap, and, B, they loved cocaine. This has made its way into pop culture. You can use this for any reference you want.
Hey, McFly!
Right?
Hey, McFly!
That means you're in trouble, moron. That's what it always means.
Or the other ones are where he always screws up the punchline, where he says, make like a tree and get out of here. Later, not episodes, but the later sequels, his own self goes back and corrects him and says, you sound like an idiot. Let's make like a tree and leave.
When you do it wrong. The plot of the movie, which we have not mentioned yet, is probably... I didn't catch this as a kid. Like, it's a whole movie about incest. That's the point of the movie. Never caught it. Like, I just thought it was a fun movie.
I didn't either, but just before we started, you know, I kind of read that, and I was like, you know what? That makes perfect sense. Yeah, it does. I never caught it either.
He goes back in time, accidentally runs into his mother, and she finds him not just good-looking, but, like, hot to try. She cannot get enough of him. And then he befriends his father, ends up bringing his parents together to right the wrong that he screwed up by going back in time. But by going back in time, he kind of brings out the best part of both of them, which they did not know. Their lives change. And when he returns to the future, he's still himself, but the world has kind of changed around him, and his parents are no longer losers. His dad is no longer a pushover at work. His mom is no longer a drunk. They actually have a really good life. His brother and sister are better people. But I always wondered, why didn't his dad start putting two and two together? And then this little bit from Family Guy, they got it figured out.
Hey, Lorraine, whatever happened to that guy Marty from high school?
Don't know. Never saw him after the prom.
Really? Sure you didn't run into him, say, about 16 years ago?
George, what are you talking about?
I'm talking about the fact that our son, who you insisted we name after that guy Marty, looks exactly like him. You think I'm an idiot? That I wouldn't notice that our son is a dead ringer for the guy who fixed us up?
Mom, Dad, I accidentally set fire to the living room rug.
I am not going easy on him.
I've never seen that.
There's another one. It's so bad. I don't even want to say it out loud, but I'll tell you anyways. So, Stewie is up on the ledge like of their house, and it's a big rainstorm, and he's got to get a rope or something. And all of a sudden, like, Michael J. Fox runs up and goes, I need to tell you something about the future. And Stewie says, no, Michael, I need to tell you something about the future.
That's so wrong.
It's so cruel, but it's very timely and funny. I have some box office mojo for you, some actual facts. Let me pull this up here. So release date, July 3rd, 1985, Universal Studio. Production budget, $19 million. Domestic gross, $210 million. In the world of a startup, when you do an investment in something high risk, you're looking for a 10x usually. You want 10 times your money back. This is an 11x. This was not only a win, it was a huge, huge win. It was nominated for 4 Academy Awards, original screenplay, sound,
sound editing and original song, and the original song was The Power of Love. It did get a win. Do you guys know which one it got the wind in? Or win in?
Hmm. Now that you do the whole list. No, I don't. I forgot.
It's the one that you would win, Bernie. Sound editing.
Yeah. I believe that because when we got our pirate, no, I mean our real VCR copy of it. And here at the house, I've got a pretty good stereo in the living room, and we've always had good sound equipment, naturally, I guess. I remember putting in the tape and the opening sequence where he's riding the skateboard, you know, around, and he's eventually gets into Doc's apartment, and things are happening from left to right, and you hear that stuff walking across the screen, you know, mm-hmm. sounds coming from here and over here and all. I thought that was the coolest thing, that they had taken the time to do that, and maybe I was last in line to notice it, but in that environment, I could finally hear it. You know, you can't really pick up on that in the mm-hmm. theater because it's so loud and so big, you know, that you kind of get lost in that, what they call the stereo field effect. You kind of lose that. But in your living room, it really comes to life. And so I was really impressed with that and listen for that often, like movies like since like Titanic, since it sank this week as we record.
Yeah.
Awesome film to watch at home, you know, if you've got a good stereo system. Lots going on in that. A lot of good sound design. So good. Yeah.
A friend, kind of a distant friend, but that is really into this movie and is not a car guy, I kind of said, someday I'll help you get a DeLorean. He always wanted it to be a Back to the Future car, and I said, it doesn't have to be that. But as I was doing my research, well, there were several different Speedo options. And DeLorean Motor Company, the new one, I believe in Houston, Bernie, so we could send you on a mission over there to get more info. But I believe one of the Speedo options, which was probably on these cars, read 5 miles per hour to 85 miles per hour.
Hmm.
Did you catch in the movie what the speedometer actually said? Now, remember, how fast do they have to go to time travel?
88.
Yeah. So if he had a speedo that said 85, how do you make it say 88? They changed the speedo. It was 15 miles an hour to 95 miles an hour. Just bump both sides up 10 so that you could get it to 88. And there were three different cars, and there's no telling which one could have had the factory like 110 or 140 or something like that. The other interesting thing is that I believe all three cars used in this movie were U.S. spec edition. And without all the movie gear and props on it, the nose of those cars would have been sitting taller than the tail. Really dorky looking. The Euro spec cars tucked down nice and low. And most people that have DeLoreans now in the U.S. put them to Euro spec, and they snug the front end down. That was strictly to pass 5 mile an hour bumper tests. It was just to get the bumper up a little bit higher. The cars that they used on set were highly unreliable. Those engines were junk. They were made junk, from what I'm told. But the way that they had configured the whole hatchback of the car was that you couldn't get to the engine without taking the car apart. So if it didn't run, you like truly had a problem. The hero car that in this movie, they labeled them A, B, and C. The hero car, after the movie was done, sat on the back lot at Universal and got picked apart by different fans that kind of snuck in and took parts off it. And it was kind of a shell of it for himself. And it was left outside the whole time, kind of like all the General Lees, right? Just sat outside. Well,
Universal was really bad about doing that with their cars. They did it with American Graffiti 32, and it sat there with no hood on it and got rained in and the motor locked up because it, you know, it's got open carburetors.
Well, some super fans broke in, one of them, and was, I don't know if he was stealing parts, but he was like their version of you. Like, he'd go in, take the part off, photo it, take drawings of it, figure out what it was made of, and then put it back on so that he could replicate it and make his own.
Huh.
And he ended up building a really accurate replica, and at some fan convention showed it to Bob Gale and Robert Zemeckis. They were so impressed with how authentic it was that they found a way to get he and his crew commissioned to restore the original car. And that car has now been fully restored back to its original status. And I think it's in the, I want to say it's in the Universal Museum somewhere. And there were more cars used throughout the series. I don't remember how many there were in the other two movies. The one that died at the end, like that got hit by a train, that was a real DeLorean that really got hit by a train that they loaded up with wet concrete so that the train would smash right through it and rip it apart, instead of just kind of knocking it out of the way. But for me, the first movie, it's the go-to. My favorite, hands down. My dad's is the third. He loves the Western. That's his favorite. But
I probably like all three of them equally. I read that the part two and part three were actually originally planned to be one movie. It got so much jumping around that they said, okay, we're going to break it up into two movies. Mm. But they filmed them consecutive. And I think they said they filmed part two and part three in 11 months. I just remember when the part two and three came out in the theaters, it was boom, boom, one right after the other. So yeah. That makes sense.
I got a deleted scene for you. This is real. I didn't make this up. This is in the garage where Doc Brown finds his suitcase from his 1985 counterpart with all of the belongings in it. You got to see this for this to all make sense. I want you to tell me what he finds at the end.
What's this thing?
It's a hairdryer.
A hairdryer? Don't they have towels in the future? Look at these underpants. They're all made of cotton. I thought for sure we'd all be wearing disposable paper garments by 1985. And what's this?
Ooh, suddenly the future's looking a whole lot better.
Do you guys know what he found?
I don't. I haven't seen that clip, but what era Doc Brown was that?
That's the 50s Doc Brown finding the 80s Doc Brown suitcase.
Was it the Ooh La La magazine?
That's what I was wondering.
It's the 1985 version of it. It's
a Playboy.
Yeah. Oh. He takes a Playboy. I'm a, whoa.
Ooh La La. Ooh La La.
There are so many deleted clips that when you see them after the fact, actually make an unbelievable movie even better. The hairdryer thing, when he's Darth Vader from the planet Vulcan, the hairdryer goes in and out of his belt in between scenes. And it's actually a longer scene filmed out. And the hairdryer that he brought is Doc Brown's, which was just the one that he found in his suitcase right there. I mean, it's...
Huh. It's one of those that you have to watch over and over and over because you'll miss little clips here and there. I mean, the little attention to detail that they had. Mm-hmm. One thing I remember reading... You know, at the very beginning of the movie, he said, meet me at the Twin Pines Mall. Of course, you know, everything happens. Marty jumps in the car. You know, he's getting away from the terrorists. And he winds up in 1955 on the farm. Mm-hmm. Well, they chase him out of the barn. And when he's hauling butt down the driveway, I can't remember if he runs that over or the farmer shoots it. It was Twin Pine Farm or whatever. Mm-hmm. And he shoots one of the pines down. Well, then later in the movie, they go back to the mall again. But now you look at the sign, it's called the whatever, Single Pine Mall or Lone Pine Mall or whatever.
I've never caught
that. Yeah, they actually, when he goes back, you know, towards the end of the movie to basically relive everything that happened before he left, look at the sign because it's like the Lone Pine Mall or something like that.
No, I think kidding.
Yeah.
I've never caught that.
Huh. It's so many little details like that that you have to watch over and over, and you pick up something every single time you watch it.
I don't remember if I noticed it the first time, but the old man, the old farmer, when they come out, his son has a comic book that's an alien invasion comic book, and there's an alien craft on the front of it with a gullwing door opening.
Right.
It has square headlights on the front of it, and then they look up, and there's the DeLorean with the gullwing door that opens.
Yeah.
It's, so, it's perfect.
His comic book's coming to life.
Nah, man, that's a good one. I will check
good
that
choice
one
for a movie, boss. Good choice.
What would you guys give this one on a scale of 1 to 10?
1 to 10 what?
1 to 10
trees,
pine trees.
Corn dogs.
Yes, pine trees.
10 pine trees.
I'd give it 10 as well. And that was another thing. Hollywood's gone to the habit of recreating old movies. They just need to leave this one alone. Don't ever try to recreate it because it's perfect just the way it is.
I, too, give it 10 pine trees. I texted Finnegan. We were talking back and forth about some other stuff. And I said, hey, off the top of your head, what is the very first line that comes to you from Back to the Future? What do you think he said?
1.21 gigawatts.
No, not that
no?
one.
Great Scott.
Huh.
Biff's favorite line, say hello to your mom for me.
That's very funny, but it's not that one. I'm going to see if I can pull up the clip. I thought I had it loaded, but I did not.
My calculations are correct. When this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're going to see some serious shit.
That's Mike's favorite. That was mine, too. That's always the one I think of first. The remote control that he has there is a Futaba brand, which I used in my old RC cars. And I remember seeing this in the theater, like, why does he have the levers reversed? Usually the lever on the left is the throttle and the right is the steering. And also, the battery indicator says it's off. Little things.
And because the right hand is like the right foot is the throttle, so you could keep them straight, perhaps.
I don't know. I couldn't figure out how it worked with a stick shift either.
Yeah, when it's a stick shift once and then it's an automatic, yeah.
All right, yes. This is a perfect 10. Everybody, if you have not seen this one or not seen it in a while, do yourself a favor and dust it off and enjoy this weekend. We have a ton of sound clips that Bernie will lovingly stick in the sound effects, which I'm sure that we can all enjoy. So, fellas, I think it's time to... This is what music can do for anything. You put this soundtrack on anything, it'll be a hit.
We had the record, actually.
Did you really?
Yeah.
The Kibbe and Friends Show, brought to you by our good friends at Holley Performance. Click the link on our show page and visit holley.com for everything air, fuel, and performance related for your ride. Connect with us on the socials and at patreon.com/KAFS. See you next week. Later on.
Oh my God. They found me. I don't know how, but they found me.
Work hard, Marty!
Who? Who?
Who do you think? The Libyans!
My calculations are correct. When this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're gonna see some serious shit.
Wait a minute, Doc. Are you telling me that you built a time machine? Out of a DeLorean?
The way I see it, if you're gonna build a time machine into a car, why not do it with some style? Besides, the stainless steel construction made the flux dispersal. Look out!
Hey, McFly!
Who's president of the United States in 1985?
Ronald Reagan.
Ronald Reagan? The actor? Then who's vice president? Jerry Lewis?
I suppose Jane Wyman is the first lady.
Whoa, wait, Doc.
And Jack Benny is secretary of the treasury.
Doc, you gotta listen to me.
I got enough practical jokes for one evening. Good night, future boy.
No, wait, Doc. Doc, the bruise in your head. I know how that happened. You told me the whole story. You were standing on your toilet, and you were hanging a clock, and you fell, and you hit your head on the sink. And that's when he came up with the idea for the flux capacitor, which is what makes time travel possible.
Chris Electrical, but I need a nuclear reaction to generate the 1.21 gigawatts of electricity.
1.21 gigawatts! 1.21 gigawatts! Great Scott!
Doc, my only hope.
Marty, I'm sorry, but the only power source capable of generating 1.21 gigawatts of electricity is a bolt of lightning.
What did you say?
A bolt of lightning. Unfortunately, you never know when or where it's ever going to strike.
We do now.
This is it. This is the answer. It says here that a bolt of lightning is going to strike the clock tower precisely 10:04 p.m. next Saturday night. If we could somehow harness this light, channel it into the flux capacitor, it just might work. Next Saturday night, we're sending you back to the future.
All right, guys, listen, this is a blues riff from B. Watch me for the changes and try and keep up, okay?
This thing.
It's a hairdryer.
A hairdryer? Don't they have towels in the future? Look at these underpants. They're all made of cotton. I thought for sure we'd all be wearing disposable paper garments by 1985. And what's this?
Ooh, suddenly the future is looking a whole lot better.
Now, in the first film, the production designer was Larry Paul, and we had decided to shoot the movie on the back lot at Universal because it simply was far more practical than going to an actual real town. We considered for a while shooting the picture up in Petaluma, California, but when we got to the reality check and realized that we would have to change out all the street lights, all the curbs would have to be modified. There were so many details that would have to be changed to go from the 80s to the 50s. It was just way too expensive and impractical to go to a distant location and do that. So we went to the back lot at Universal, and of course, a production designer gets to do a whole lot more when he has an empty shell.
You're my Uncle Joey. Better get used to these bars, kid.
What?
I've never seen purple underwear before, Calvin.
Calvin, why do you keep calling me Calvin?
Well, that is your name, isn't it? Calvin Klein? It's written all over your underwear. Oh, I guess they call you Cal, huh?
No, actually, people call me Marty.
Hey, Lorraine, whatever happened to that guy Marty from high school?
Don't know. Never saw him after the prom.
Really? Sure you didn't run into him, oh, say, about 16 years ago?
George, what are you talking about?
I'm talking about the fact that our son, who you insisted we name after that guy Marty, looks exactly like him. You think I'm an idiot? That I wouldn't notice that our son is a dead ringer for the guy who fixed us up?
Mom, Dad, I accidentally set fire to the living room rug.
I am not going easy on him.
Chuck!
My lord, the ship appears to be deserted.
How can that be? They're hiding.
Yes, sir. But the bridge seems to be run by computer. It is the only thing speaking.
Speaking? Let me hear.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5.
Get out!
3,
get out of there! Get out!
1.
For a million years.
And I bet we'll be together for a million more.
Oh, it's like I started breathing on the night we kissed. And I can't remember what I ever did before. What would we do, baby?
We're
we're locked into the DeLorean. That's what we want to do. We had the product placement people at Universal. They're always trying to promote deals, right?
Right, right.
And so one day, the guy that they'd hired to actually do the product placement deals, he comes into my office. He says, Bob, we can get the production $75,000. $75,000 on this deal I'm about to lay out for you. I say, okay, Richard, what's the deal? He says, change the DeLorean to a Mustang. I looked at him. I said, Doc Brown doesn't drive a Mustang.
Right, right.
That was it.
Wow. That was $75,000 out the window.
Worth it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's...
You.